I sing for all that you've done for me. Come on, put your hands together with us as we celebrate the amazing grace of our God. Stronger, the King of glory, the King of all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King of all kings.
stone rolled away. He is risen, he is risen, he's alive. See his hands, see his feet, and touch his scars and believe. He is risen, he is risen, he's alive.
Welcome again to Orchard Hill. Wasn't that great just to hear our team lead in some singing and see familiar faces if Orchard Hill has been your church home? And if you're brand new to Orchard Hill through this online experience, it's great to have you be a part of what Orchard Hill is. We have our weekend services every weekend right now online, 6 p.m. Saturday, Sunday at 9:30 and 11:15, all Eastern time zones. As well as a lot of ways for students and kids to connect, a lot of ways for adults to connect in groups and in studies. All of that is available online. You can see where that's at. And this has actually been cool. We've actually had our small groups grow during this time substantially. And so this is a great time just to jump into some relationship, some connection while you have some time at home. And you can do it digitally from anywhere. We also just want to keep reminding you that we are having our evening devotions every weeknight at 8:30 p.m. And that's another great way and time to connect. But I just want to take a few moments here today to talk especially about a few of the things that we're doing in the community right now through our Elios ministry. We continue, as we have for over a decade, to support Light of Life, which provides meals to the homeless and hurting in our community. And so that's one of our primary partners. But we've also begun a food bank here at Orchard Hill Wexford. And so many people have brought food here. And if you know of people or if you're hurting who need help, you can refer them to our Elios ministry. Elios just means a gift of mercy. It's a Greek word. And that's something that we are doing as well for people in our community. And many of you have given specifically to the Elios Fund. And that fund goes to help people in our church family who are coming up against some substantial needs. So if you want to give to that or you're aware of a need, please reach out to the church here. Also, if you're watching today, partaking today, and you want somebody to pray with you, we have hosts both at Church Online and on Facebook Live that would love to interact with you, pray with you. In addition, we just sent a check to a church that we've partnered with in Haiti for over a decade, Hope Baptist Church, and are helping them through this time. And so I just want to thank you for your generosity to Orchard Hill through this time. It's allowed us to continue to support Light of Life, to support the church in Haiti, to continue the ministries that are happening here at a high level. And if you're a person who hasn't ever given, maybe you're a high schooler, college student, young adult, and you've never really given, one great way to do this is to download the church app, because I know you probably don't have a checkbook, if that's you. And so you can download the church app, Orchard Hill Church. Make sure you get the green leaf that kind of goes to the right. There's an imposter, I like to say, out there. It's not really an imposter. There's a church in Iowa with the same name. So if you just put in Orchard Hill, you might get them, but they have a different color scheme. And we know that some people gave there that meant to give here, and some people have given there that meant to give here. So make sure you get Orchard Hill. And in there, you can specify Strip District, Butler County. You can specify Wexford. You can specify Elios. Great way just to participate. And really, more than just giving to the church, it's a way for you just to say in this time, I am trusting God. I'm sure some of us have found this to be a hard time, losing income, losing jobs. Maybe you're, like I said, a college student or a high school student saying, how will I have enough money for the fall? What will my fall look like? But to take any portion of income that you get and give some of it back to the work of God is just a great way to be engaged in trusting during this time. And what I'd really like to do is just take a moment and pray with all of us wherever we are. As I said, I know some have experienced financial challenges, certainly with the business shutdown. I can't imagine how hard for some people this time has been. And then there are health concerns. And then we want to take a moment and pray for our leaders as well. The New Testament encourages us to do that. And this is such a challenging time for our governors, for our elected officials, for our president, for the Congress, for the courts to make decisions that are best. And so we just want to take a moment and pray. So would you pray with me? Father, we come to you right now. And Lord, wherever each of us are today, Lord, we know that there are some who right now are hurting economically. We pray for your provision. God, we know that there are some who are experiencing health concerns, either related to COVID or not related to COVID. And God, we pray that you would be present and work in those situations in powerful ways. We pray for healing. Father, we also just lift up our leaders to you as they make decisions right now that impact all of us, that they would be able to balance economic issues with health issues. And Lord, we know that nobody's pro one without being for the other, that we want all of that to work together. And so God, we ask that you would work in our country, in and through these leaders. And God, we pray just for families as they maybe struggle just being home together day after day. And Lord, we pray that you would would birth deeper, better relationships than maybe what has been there before. And so, Father, we lift all these things to you, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're in this series in the book of Joel, and now we're going to hear a part of the book of Joel read, and then we'll jump into our teaching.
Pastor Kurt will be teaching from the book of Joel, chapter 2, verses 1 through 27, and I will be reading from Joel 2, verses 11 through 20. The Lord thunders at the head of his army. His forces are beyond number, and mighty is the army that obeys his command. The day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it? Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the people, consecrate the assembly, bring together the elders, gather the children, those nursing at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. Let the priests who minister before the Lord weep between the portico and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, Lord. Do not make your inheritance an object of scorn, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? Then the Lord was jealous for his land and took pity on his people. The Lord replied to them, I am sending you grain, new wine, and olive oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. I will drive the northern horde far from you, pushing it into a parched and barren land. Its eastern ranks will drown in the Dead Sea, and its western ranks in the Mediterranean Sea. And its stench will go up, its smell will rise. Surely he has done great things. This is the word of the Lord.
So let me ask you this. Have you ever been in a place where you had to pull a fire alarm, where you knew that there was a danger and you were the one who had to decide, is this enough of a danger that's worthy of pulling a fire alarm or not? And let me just ask the question this way. Have you ever pulled a fire alarm just as a joke? Chances are some of you have, and maybe if you're sitting with your family, parents, that could be a story you could tell your kids a little later on. I've never had to pull a fire alarm personally, but I remember one night a few years back, my wife and I were in a hotel, and throughout the night, the fire alarm kept sounding, and we were on a higher floor, and so you weren't supposed to use the elevator, and so three different times during the night, we had to vacate our room, walk down all the flights of stairs out onto the street to be told it was a false alarm, and then we would go back up, fall asleep, and the fire alarm would go off again, and all of this, and there was never an explanation. My guess is there was somebody in the lounge who probably thought it was funny or something like that to make this all happen. But what happened was soon you got to a point where you said this fire alarm doesn't mean anything. People can say whatever they want to say, but I don't believe there's a fire. Well, we began a series in the book of Joel last weekend talking about how and where God is in a pandemic. And what we saw in chapter 1 is that when life is disrupted, God is inviting people to cry out to him to see that we don't have as much control as we think we do, that our resources aren't as meaningful or as substantial as we think they are, that our pleasures aren't as lasting as we think they are, but that we're not as hopeless as we think we are either, because we can cry out to God and God responds well to the people who cry out to him. But in chapter 2, we begin with this, and this is really about this locust plague. It says, blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy hill. Let all who live in the land tremble, for the day of the Lord's coming is close at hand. And so here, it's in essence like Joel is saying, I want you to pull a fire alarm. Now, they didn't have fire alarms back then, but what he was saying was blow the trumpet, sound the alarm. The day of the Lord's coming is close at hand. And so he said, because of the locust plague, chapter 1, verse 4 and following talks about this locust plague. And locusts were grasshoppers that basically came in mass and destroyed vegetation. This would be like a group of teenage boys at a pizza party just sweeping their way through the pizza and nothing is left, okay? This is actually worse than that because it leaves devastation. And what Joel says is, I want you to sound the alarm because when you see a disruption like this, it means that the Lord's coming is at hand. The Lord's day, the day of the Lord is at hand. But what happens is sometimes we see disasters come and go and we start to feel like I felt that night in the hotel room. Maybe there's nothing to this fire alarm. Maybe there will be no future real day of the Lord. But Joel says very clearly here that he wants us to understand that there is coming a day and that the day of disruption and disaster that we experience is actually a harbinger of a different day, the day of the Lord. Now, I gave you a definition last week from J.D. Barker. I want to read it again. I want to put it on the screen just so you see this because this is helpful in understanding this term, the day of the Lord, when it appears, especially in prophetic literature. He says this, the day of the Lord is a significant recurring theme in the prophetic literature of the Old Testament. At its essence, it refers to a visitation, refers to Yahweh's unmistakable and powerful intervention. The prophets employ both the specter of the day of the Lord to offer both a warning and hope, announcing disaster and salvation. I couldn't read my own writing very well, so it would be better to read it off the screen. But here's the point of this, and that is what the day of the Lord is in the Old Testament is this day that has two different kind of connotations. One is this idea of disaster and hardship, and the other is the day of salvation. And the prophet Joel here says, when you see a problem or a disaster, know that it is a harbinger of this day to come. And here's what we tend to think in America about our Christianity, and that is that God brings victory to our lives over and over again, and that if we just walk in faith, then we can have victory from one victory to another. But here's what we see in the Old Testament. I love how J.R.R. Tolkien said this in one of his letters once, as he said, the Christian life is basically a long defeat with occasional victories until we actually get to the end when it's all victory. And here's the point. We tend to think that if my life's going to be good, it needs to be full of good things, you know, good teeth, good hair, good skin, good spouse, good income, good job, maybe good genetics or a good metabolism, good vacations, good retirement account. And if all those goods come together, then my life will be good. Instead of understanding that there will be hard days, and when those hard days come, they can actually be a display of what I can look to and say, this is telling me something about how God's going to interact with this world. And so Joel basically says, I want you to sound the alarm because when you see a disaster, when you see a disruption, it's a harbinger that there is a day of the Lord that's actually coming. Now you may say, well, are you saying, Kurt, that God caused this pandemic? And my answer is, I have no idea. And I don't think anybody really does, because to say that you know what God did would presume that you have knowledge of something that you really don't have knowledge of. Now, biblically, we know that in Joel's day that God did bring the locusts. But we also know, again, from Job that when Job suffered, that it was Satan's work. It wasn't God who took credit for it. So biblically, you can get both sides. But here's what we do know for sure, and that is that in the midst of this plague that came on the people of Joel's day, that God was in their midst. Verse 27 of chapter 2, then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. What he says is, I'm in the midst of this pandemic. And what that tells us is that God has not taken his hand off of this situation. That God isn't sitting around going, oh my goodness, what happened? COVID-19. I had no idea. But God is using it for something. I like how Tony Evans, a pastor and author, put it. He said, he's not sitting by as a spectator. He is the invisible hand working behind the scenes of the good and the bad and the ugly. In the New Testament, we're told that God is one who is not slow concerning his coming. This is 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 and 9. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. And what that is pointing to is this idea that when God kind of relents from the disaster, that what he's doing is he's extending a time of patience. And that's what we end up seeing in the book of Joel, is that the people in their current situation were not hopeless. And I would say what it points out to you and to me is that we are never hopeless in our current situation. Let me just read you a part of what's later in this book, verse 19. Then the Lord replied to them, I'm sending you grain, new wine, and olive oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. And so what God does is, after the people have turned, and we'll talk about this in just a moment, he says, I'm going to send you new grain. I'm going to send you so much that I will satisfy you completely. You'll have everything that you want and need. Then verse 25, he says, I will repay to you for the years the locusts have eaten. I think the ESV says, I'll restore to you. In other words, I'll give you back what has been taken away. The great locust, the young locust, the other locust, the locust swarm. My great army that I am sending among you, you will have plenty to eat until you are full. You will praise the name of the Lord, our God, your God, who has worked wonders for you. In other words, what he says here is, I am going to bring grace. And then in verse 20, he says, in essence, I'm going to turn away this army, because the way that the book begins is this locust plague. And then in chapter 2, the locusts signify this army that might be coming. He says, I'll drive the northern horde far from you, pushing it to a parched and barren land. Its eastern ranks will drown in the Dead Sea, and the western ranks in the Mediterranean Sea. And its stench will go up, and its smell will rise. Here's what he's saying is, I'm going to give you grace. I'm going to give you something you don't deserve. I'm going to give you mercy. I'm not going to give you what you deserve. And I'm going to satisfy you. Verse 19. Now, sometimes when we say mercy and grace and those things, we see them as all just interchangeable words. But here's maybe a way to think about it. Evidently, there's a shortage of toilet paper in terms of some of the stores right now. And so people have been buying and trying to keep toilet paper. Let's imagine just that you ran really low on toilet paper. And you heard that the Bjorklunds had plenty. And so you came over to my house, you snuck into my house, and you tried to steal toilet paper from my house. But I caught you. My watchdog, Zion, caught you in the middle of the night. And so you were there red-handed. Now, mercy is me saying, I'm not going to press charges, just go, and I'm not going to hold you responsible for what you've done, breaking into my house. Grace would be to say, I'm going to give you toilet paper. Since you need toilet paper, here, take some toilet paper and go. Now, satisfaction doesn't really work on that analogy, but if it was food, if you came into my house to take food, then I gave you food, that'd be grace. If I said, I'm not going to press charges, that would be mercy. Satisfaction would be saying, let me give you the best food that I have so that you can be satisfied. That's what God says he will do in this event for the people of Joel's day. Now, there's a condition, and the condition is this, and we see this in verses 12 and 13. It says this, even now declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord, our God, your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Do you see the word return? It shows up here twice. verse 12 and verse 13. In other words, the hope in the midst of something has a lot to do with the people who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ saying, I'm going to return to God. In chapter 1, there was a universal call. All people cry out to the Lord. Here, this is a return, which means he's calling people who already have some kind of a relationship with the God of Israel in this case. In our day, it would be with Jesus Christ. And he's saying, if you return to me, then I'll be active in this situation. And to turn, it's the Hebrew word sub, and it's a very common word for just physically turning, but it came to mean, and when it was used like this, repentance, or to turn from going one direction and go another direction. And so the idea is you're going away from God, turn and come back to God. And then he says in verse 14, who knows, maybe I'll relent. Who knows, maybe God will relent. Maybe God will change what he's doing. And so what I'd like to do is just point out a few things that returning means. It means returning, and I'm going to say first, without pride. And I think we see this in verses 12 and 13 with just this idea of fasting, weeping, mourning, with the idea of saying returning because it connotes an idea of saying, in essence, that you or that I don't have a perfect alignment with God. In the New Testament, there's a story in Luke 15 about the prodigal son is how it's titled, but it's a really bad title. Because it isn't about the son, it's actually about God. It's about the love of God. And there's two sons. One son goes to the father and says, I'd like all of my inheritance now. And then he goes to the far country and we're told that he spends it on wild living. And he comes to his senses and he comes home and his father goes out to greet him. And we're told that he runs to greet him and says, let's kill the fattened calf. In other words, let's throw a feast for my son who has lost his home. And I want to just shower this child with goodness. And the older son gets ticked off because the older son says, you know, I've been here the whole time and you've never thrown a party for me. And here's why I say that turning to God involves coming without pride. Here's what some of us will do is we'll say, this is a good message and I hope somebody else hears it who needs to repent. And we won't think that we need to repent because we'll think that we have lived at such a level that we've not needed to repent. And here's how you know that you're the older brother or that you're the person who has pride is whenever you say, I know that somebody else needs this more than me, or you question somebody else's validity of their repentance. I saw something recently back when our country used to have concerts. Evidently, Lady Gaga was at a concert, and she took some time in her concert to talk about a political figure whose wife had worked at a Christian school. And evidently, the Christian school had taken a historic position on sexuality and had taught some things and encouraged students to follow those things. And if students didn't, then they said, you can't be a student here. And Lady Gaga was evidently quite offended by this. And so here's what she said. She said, you, and she named this politician by name, are wrong. You are one of the worst representatives of what it means to be a Christian. This is a well-known person who has claimed to be a Christian. She said, I'm a Christian woman, and what I do know about Christianity is that we bear no prejudice and everybody is welcome. So you can take all that disgrace, Mr. So-and-so, and you can look yourself in the mirror and you'll find it right there. Now, here's why I read this and why I point to this. A lot of fans are like, yeah, this is great. And I think it's great if Lady Gaga identifies as a Christian, and I have no reason to question anything around that other than this, and that is when you infer that there are no moral absolutes. Do you know what Lady Gaga did in that quote? Is she said, but there is a moral absolute, and the moral absolute is you have to, what? Accept everybody. Now, she's absolutely right that Christianity bears no prejudice, and it accepts everybody, but do you know what she did? She said, everybody except the person I don't like who holds a different view than me and who I see as being reprehensible. And so all of a sudden, what she's doing is she's saying, saying, I'll come to Jesus, but that person can't come to Jesus, who holds a view on sexuality I don't like, who holds an absolute standard. Now, without debating, and the reason I didn't tell you the name and go into the exact issues, I don't want this to be about that issue, but here's what pride does. Pride says, in essence, I don't need to repent, other people need to repent, and I don't like those people. Those people don't do what I think they should do, therefore, they don't belong. And here's one of the real challenges of Christianity, is it isn't who it keeps out, but it's who it lets in. Because the real Christian message, Lady Gaga is absolutely right. It does not bear any prejudice. In other words, when she says anyone can come, anyone can turn to Jesus, anyone can return. And how you know that you aren't actually ready to repent yourself is when you start to say, but I don't think that person has repented enough, or I don't think that they're enough of this, or I don't like their view of this, therefore they don't make the cut. And what that becomes is a way of pride. Here's a second way, or a second part of returning, and I'm going to say it's returning without conditions. So we return without pride, we return without conditions. And this is in verse 12. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart. Do you recognize that phrase? It's the same phrase, by the way, that Jesus used in Matthew 22 when he said, here are the greatest commandments. What? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. And what Jesus was doing was he was taking this Old Testament idea and saying that if you want to fulfill what Jesus asked, then you will say, I will love you with all my heart, not with part of my heart, not with some of my heart, but with all of my heart. And so when Joel says here, return to me with all of your heart, what he's doing is he's saying, you'll come back to God without conditions, without saying, I'll give you everything but this. I don't know if you've ever had a box in your house that was your box and nobody else should go in that box. I've had one of those boxes for years. It used to be under my bed, and it was just some memorabilia, some things that I thought were important, and I just never wanted anyone to go in it because I just didn't want to lose stuff or anything like that. And a few years ago, we cleaned out our bedroom and took the stuff out from under the bed, and the box went away. And it was actually a symbolic moment because there was nothing actually in the box that was all that significant. I mean, there were tickets to like an all-star game I had gone to. There were, you know, some letters, some things, stuff like that. But for years, it was nobody can touch this box. So here's my question. Do you have a box somewhere in your life that you're saying, God, I'll turn everything over to you except this? God, I'll turn back to you, but don't ask me to surrender to you, and you fill in the blank, whatever that is. You see, real returning to God abandons conditions. It comes without pride, and it comes without conditions. But here's a third thing that we see, and that is returning to God, I think, also comes without show. Verse 13, rend your hearts and not your garments. Rend your hearts and not your garments. And at some point, what happens when we come to Christ for forgiveness, when we return to God in repentance, is we come and we say, I don't care who knows, and I don't care what it costs. To rend your garments was to do something for display, for show. It was a way of people saying, look, I'm repenting. In fact, Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount says, when you do your fasting, do it in such a way that nobody knows. In other words, if you have to tell everybody that you're fasting becomes null and void. If you have to repent in such a way that everyone knows you're repenting, then what you're doing is you're doing a repenting for everyone to know. Your best repentance will be of the heart. In other words, it will be internal, authentic, not external, and on display. Now, that doesn't mean that there's never a time for a public act of repentance. In fact, this passage goes on to talk about that. But what the author's saying is there has to be something that happens in your heart internally that changes the way that you live internally. I heard a pastor talk about this. I haven't been able to actually find the article, so I don't know if this is entirely true or a pastor story, but he said that he read an article about a Christian leader who was caught up in the Ashley Madison thing a few years ago. I don't know if you remember that, but there's a website evidently where people who want to cheat can find other married people who want to cheat. And at some point, all of the names were made public, and a man with this national ministry, his name had been on there, and his board asked him to resign, forced him to resign. And he said, "At first, I thought that this was such a harsh criticism, harsh judgment from God. But," he said, "what I came to see is that it was actually God's mercy, because by that coming out," and he said he had never acted on it, he just registered for it in an act of kind of desperation one day and never acted, but he said, "it allowed me to have conversations with my wife and save my marriage, and even though it cost me my ministry, it was worth it because it saved me and my marriage, all untold pain." Now, here's why I say this when we talk about without show. What he said is if that hadn't come out, he said, "I could keep repenting of things publicly for show, but because that came out, all of a sudden," he said, "I had to deal with the reality of what was broken in my own life." And so when we say repent without show, what we're saying is deal with the reality that's there, whatever that is. And when you do, that's when we encounter the real mercy of God. I would add this, and that is to repent without presumption, or to turn without presumption. Verse 14 puts it this way. It says, "Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God." What does he say here? He says, "Who knows?" And I don't think that this is a question as much of do we know what God will do, as much as a question of saying this is not about presumption. Because here's what we've seen. We've seen the character of God. Verse 13, "Return to the Lord your God, for he's gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love. He relents from sending calamity." We see that he does it for his own purposes. Verse 17, "Let the priest who minister before the Lord weep in the portico and the altar. Let them say, 'Spare your people, Lord. Do not make your inheritance an object of scorn.'" In other words, God does this for his own purposes, that it isn't something that by us getting our repentance just right, or us being somehow active in what we do, that we obligate God to us. God does for us what God wants to do. And here's what this means. A lot of times people think that Christianity is about us doing some big thing for God. But the gospel is about God doing a big thing for us. And repentance isn't a way to obligate God to us. It's a way to say, "God, I recognize my desperate need for you. And so I come and I'm at your mercy. And who knows, maybe you'll relent in a situation and give me something different. But as of today, I am coming just simply to say, here's who I am and where I am." And then I would say, lastly, that we see here to turn or return to God without delay. Verse 15 and 16 have the urgency. Verse 15 again, "Blow the trumpet in Zion, declare a holy fast." Now, you had a trumpet at the beginning of warning. Here you have a trumpet saying, "Declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the people, consecrate the assembly, bring together the elders, the children, those nursing at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber." These are images of urgency, saying, if you are to come, come without a delay. When David sinned in the Old Testament with Bathsheba, he had been married, he had looked around, and he had beckoned Bathsheba to his chambers. He slept with her, ended up eliminating her husband, killing her husband, having him killed. And when he prayed a prayer of repentance in Psalm 51, verse 4, he said, "It's against you, Lord, against you alone that I have sinned." And in Hebrew, the language that underlies our Old Testament, there's no way of saying very sorrowful, so you repeat something twice. So when he says, "It's against you only have I sinned," the two times what he's doing by repeating it is he's saying, "God, it's against you that I've sinned." In other words, he's saying, when I came to understand this, I understand that it was you that I was grieving. And the intensification becomes his way of saying, now I have to do something about it. When he recognized his need to turn, he said, "Okay, I need to do this and I need to do it now." Last weekend, we talked just for a moment about repenting and using the prayers of Daniel 9, Nehemiah 9, maybe Psalm 51, just as a way to say, "God, I come to you once again and say, God, I'm turning to you." But the point of saying do it urgently is if you're feeling any sense of conviction in this moment, anything from saying, okay, God, maybe you've got my attention in a way that you hadn't before. Maybe just as we've talked here today, there's been something that's been in your mind that you say, I should really deal with that. That's been in my box. And maybe today is just a day to say, don't let that feeling pass. Don't just say, I'm going to go eat and go for a walk and forget about it. But go to God and say, God, I'm bringing it to you. Now, just before I close, I just want to share something that has been helpful to me, because sometimes I can feel like, you know, as long as I've been at this Christian thing, I should be farther along. Like, why does God allow there to still be some remaining sin? And John Newton, who had written the song Amazing Grace, wrote in his journals late in his life about this idea of remaining sin. And here's what he said, and the reason I find this helpful is if you're a person of real faith and you come to Jesus without pride, you're going to find that you have to keep repenting over and over again. You see, sometimes it's our goodness that keeps us from Jesus. We get so good at what we do that we say, I don't need to repent anymore. But as you actually mature in your faith, what will happen is you'll realize that there are things you didn't realize you needed to repent for that you need to repent for. And sometimes the very goodness that you do is not motivated correctly. Remaining sin. Here's what John Newton wrote. He said, the gracious purposes of indwelling sin are manifold. Hereby, his own power, wisdom, faithfulness, and love are more significantly displayed. Then he goes on a little later and he says this, the unchangeableness of the Lord's love and the riches of his mercy are likewise more illustrated by the multiplied pardons he bestows upon his people than if they needed no forgiveness at all. When after long experience of their own deceitful hearts, after repeated proofs of their weakness, willfulness, ingratitude, and insensibility, they find that none of these things can separate them from the love of Christ, love of God in Christ Jesus, it becomes more and more precious to their souls. They love much more because they have been forgiven more. So here's the thing. You may be afraid today to say, I need to return to God. You may be sitting here with pride saying, no, I'm pretty good. But the more you can identify and return to God and experience his grace, the more precious Jesus will be to you. The more satisfied you will be in Jesus. The more you will experience that grace and mercy, the restoration of the years the locusts have eaten. You know, we're living in a time of disruption, not unlike the time of Joel's day. And what happened then was God said, return to me, basically through the prophet Joel. And who knows, maybe I'll relent and I'll restore the years the locusts have eaten away. But he wants us to know that it's a picture. It's a picture of his ultimate grace in Jesus Christ. And that although the disaster of that day was a harbinger, if you just see it like a repeated fire alarm, sooner or later you'll be so kind of deadened to the sound that you won't turn back to what's sweetest and what's best. But if you can say, this is an alarm, and this is a time and an opportunity to say, God, I want to return to you and experience and savor the goodness of your character, then you can let this be a day or a season of that becoming true for you in a way that will satisfy your soul. God will restore the years that the locusts have eaten. Let's take a moment and pray together. Father, I thank you just for each person who's partaking and listening right now. And God, for those who maybe today is a day of recognizing their sin for the first time, I pray that there would be an understanding of that sin and a reality of saying, I need to call on Jesus as my Savior. God, for those who've been Christians for a long time and have maybe just started to think that they don't have anything to turn from, anything to repent from anymore. God, I pray that just like Paul and David and Moses and so many throughout the pages of Scripture knew that they had to continue to return, Peter, that there would be that urgency, the setting aside of pride and presumption and conditions to say, God, I come back to you. I wave the white flag of surrender and say, God, I will do your bidding with my days. And God, who knows, maybe you'll relent. And let this disaster be a fire alarm that just points us to the ultimate day of your returning, the day of the Lord. And that we would live with that day in mind because of the days that we're living in. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As I walk this great unknown, questions come and questions go. Was there a purpose for the pain? Did I cry these tears in vain? I don't want to live in fear. I want to know that you're near. And trust your grace can be seen in both triumph and tragedy. But I have this hope in the depth of my soul. In the flood of sometimes my faith feels thin, like the night will never end. Will you catch every tear, or will you just leave me here? But I have this hope in the depth of my than this breath that I take. You calm the storm when I hear you call my name. I still believe that one day I'll see your face. Yeah, I have this in the depth of my soul, in the flood or the fire, you're with me. Yeah, I have this hope in the depth of my soul.
What's up, good people? My name is David Bowens, and I'm a worship leader here at Orchard Hill Church.
And my name is Chris Jameson. I'm also a worship leader here at Orchard Hill Church. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, go ahead and hit that subscribe button.
If you want to check out more, there should be something popping up around now about a recent upload on this screen. Please check it out, and we have so many more other videos for you guys to check out.
Thanks again for watching.
We'll catch you guys next time.